Anovi, Elio ye a tijbi, Elio ye a gilodi, Bemero be yova ya eleni, Emishia bandove, Ishan shakine, Lishamokeye, Isbisha shuloim, Ayadi kisye.
Hello, is there anyone there?
Who is that?
Where are you? Did you come by plane or by photography?
Hello, Yekaterinburg. I'm sorry I can't be there. I'm here and not here. I'm there and not there. A very strange form of self-displacement.
The suitcase that contains the world. Wittgenstein's first proposition in the Tractatus. In this case, it's a suitcase. Map upside down. Where is north? Where is south? What's on the other side? It's like going through Alice's mirror. Climbing the ladder into a world where the logic is backwards. The Antipodes has always been a geography of the imagination. Here, a blend of two worlds, to meet you in Yekaterinburg halfway, a sickle with an Australian eucalyptus leaf. And as I speak, the Biennale of Sydney 2008 is in my institution where I work, the Art Gallery of New South Wales. A tattlin tower has been erected of local indigenous materials and the Australian Aboriginal flag at the top. Vitrines that tell Tatlin's story, Vladimir Tatlin, and an Aboriginal story with lots of echoes, very cleverly put together. Now, the Antipodes, slide 13, the invention of the European imagination, it's a model for nearly all our encounters with the other. We project onto other people our illusions, whether dreams, seeing noble savages, or our nightmares, like this, hallucinating less than human cannibals. Do you remember Manzoni's Socle du Monde, an upside-down magic base bearing on its surface the entire world so that everything is recognized as a work of art? In everyday people follow signs pointing to some place which is not their home but a chosen destination. Road signs, embarkation signs, terminal signs. On arrival, they come to realize they are not in the place indicated by the signs they follow. Where they now find themselves has the correct latitude, longitude, local time, currency, yet it does not have the specific gravity of the destination they chose. They are beside the place they chose to come to. The distance which separates them from it is incalculable. Maybe it's only the width of a thoroughfare. Maybe it's a world away. Skinny suki osta site ukache. Migrancy once meant continuity, now it means disjuncture. Hossein Valamanesh, born in a remote town near the Pakistan border, an Australian artist now. This work embodies the desires and disjunctions of finding oneself in a new land and integrating into an alien landscape. A Persian carpet is a landscape of the imagination already, and here, a photo of it burning in the Australian bush of Mallee Scrub. The central medallion of the carpet is having been burnt leaves a dark and velvety void, a place of possibilities.
Okay.
Longing.
This is a photo of my parents from the 30s, before I was born. They're in Cairo, and at this particular time there was a song, a very popular song called Missi Lulu, that for me represents an extraordinary cross-fertilization of cultures. Missi Lulu brings together Greek and Turkish and Arabic and Jewish klezmer music. And it points out that mélange, mixing this and that together, is very much a part of what culture is about.
This Greek diaspora community spoke French at school, English at work, Italian at home, Arabic in the markets, and mixed with Muslims, Sephardic Jews, Armenians, everyone. They look back at their pre-NASA life as a kind of paradise lost. In my family home in Australia, a sentence would begin in one language and finish in another from a choice of five. Cross-linguistic puns were common, so that even a weather forecast in English could be translated into a kind of Finnegan's Wake. My father used to tell me a jeu d'esprit that relied for its wit on a combination of Greek and French. Depuis que je la trêve, Zestanov la flog d'estimate qui me pirpolis qui me raralève jusqu'à ton pat. That's all that I can remember. Missi Lulu's origins are much argued about, but I think it was more likely the genius of Sayed Darwish, born 1892-1923, who died very young, at 31. He recorded it in 1919, employing Greek session musicians available at the time. Missi Lulu is Egyptian girl. Melodies of such depth, colour and suspense, crafted out of such small bodies of notes, made it enormously appealing. Most people in the West know Missi Lulu as Dick Dale's signature piece of surf rock instrumental over the opening credits of Pulp Fiction. It's probably the surf anthem. Dick Dale's real name is Richard Mansour. He came from American Lebanese, and he probably heard the song from his uncles who worked in the ethnic nightclub scene. Most recently, the song was selected by the Athens 2004 Organizing Committee as one of the most influential Greek songs of all time and was heard on venues in the closing ceremony performed by Anna Vissi. Younger ones in the audience will probably recognize it in the Black Eyed Peas sampling called Pump It. So from a Greek rebetiko, Middle Eastern belly dancing, Jewish wedding music klezmer, it also became known to Armenian Americans as a snake dance due to the sinuous foot movements. So it's extraordinary that this melody has such a cross-cultural style. Listen here to Michael Patrinos. Michael Patrinos from the 1930s. There we have the Turkish pronunciation, Muzurlu, rather than Missi Lulu. And then even Rabbi Abu Lafia is somebody who's taken it on as well. A doo-wop group, a black singing group called the Cardinals, also had a version. Shadows creep across purple sand. That's a version made in 1955. So this cross-pollinating of cultural exchange, this syncretism, mutual poachings, is basic to culture itself. And this is probably the takeaway for this particular talk today. It's an intercultural mixing, which I believe is the founding process in the survival of culture. As I said before, Salman Rushdie has had to defend with his life the hybrid style, or mongrelization, against the absolutism of the pure, the melange, the hodgepodge, a bit of this and a bit of that, is how newness enters the world, he says. The narrator of Misilu sings to and about his distant love, the titular Oriental princess, while the song swells with stylized obsession. And of course the exotic desires uncorked by travel make for a messy romance, blending recognition and rejection. A critique of exoticism, of course, is very common. Anybody who's studying this area cannot evade Edward Said's critique of Orientalism with the syndrome of condescending Eurocentric scholarship. But few of his followers have Said's ethical subtlety and tend to use it as a blunt instrument. But should we stifle all desires in an alien encounter? Should desires of this kind be seen only as dangerous? Is any manifestation of desire or the unfettered imagination be considered problematic? Do we give up on new relationships because desires are untidy?
Okay. So when two people who don't speak the same language meet, what should they do?
Keep talking.
Translation
becomes
transport.
Desert shadows creep across purple sands. Natives kneel in prayer by their caravans. They're silhouetted under an eastern star. I see my long-lost blossom of Shalmar. You, Misilu, are the moon and the sun, fairest one. Oh, temple bells are calling across the sand. We'll find our kismet answering love's command.